and welcome to Lety Does Playing Shadows Over Fire. So as you can see, I'm at a rental right now instead of my small library study room, and that's why I'm not wearing a mask, and that's also why my audio's kinda echoey. It's kinda the trade-off. Rentals are nice to film at, but there's not really a lot of furniture or personal belongings on the walls to absorb the sound. So I am here to play Shadows Over Fire, which is set in the universe of the late Joe Deaver's Lone Wolf. For those of you that don't know what Lone Wolf is, there are better people to explain that to you, so I'm going to be linking to some information and videos in the description below. But as a brief overview, it is an extremely long-running fantasy series written by, as I mentioned, the late Joe Deaver, and I don't know what the copyright-free term for this is. I know Choose Your Own Adventure gets really upset when you call it that, but it's basically that. It's a Choose Your Own Path book. But yeah, the main series spans over 30 books, initially written by Joe Deaver and now taken over by his son, Ben DeVere, and it is roughly inspired by Dungeons & Dragons. Joe Deaver is actually one of the OG Dungeons & Dragons players. I believe he was the first British winner of the 2E competition. So he would play these epic war games set in this fantasy world that he created, and when Dungeons & Dragons came out, he was inspired to tell his own story set in the world of Magnamund. The influences of which become immediately clear when you look here. You have the action chart, which is not unlike Dungeons & Dragons character sheets. You have some abilities, and here you have the numbered sections telling you where to go, because as I mentioned, this is a choosable adventure. And what makes it even more like Dungeons & Dragons is everything in the main series takes place in one serial continuity. So you play as Lone Wolf, and everything that you learn and you gain in this book would carry over with you onto the next one and through your adventure. Not that any of this matters. We're not playing this today. We are playing Shadows Over Fire, which is the prologue to the new Huntress trilogy written by Jonathan Sark that takes place still in the world of Magnamund 50 years before the events of Lone Wolf. And I would show off the Huntress trilogy, but I don't have it because this isn't a sponsored video. Because like all of my videos, people are smart enough not to give me money for my insane fan ravings. Because unlike the other fandoms that I am a part of, I am still actively learning from this. I don't have a Wikipedia level knowledge of Lone Wolf or Magnamund like I do about Ben 10 or One Piece. So we are going to be learning a little more about that world today as we play Shadows Over Fire, which, as I mentioned, is a prologue that you can play for free online, kind of showing what the Huntress trilogy is going to be like. But yeah, with that, kind of a long intro, lots of context to cover, but let's get started. All right, so I'm going to check my notes real quick. I'm just gonna start reading. Oh, I apologize in advance to Jonathan Sark and to everyone over at Magnamund if I pronounce anything wrong, because I know that there is a podcast where if you listen to it, you can learn all the pronunciations for things, but I have not listened to it, so I may pronounce something wrong. Sorry to everyone. Shadows Over Fire, an adventure by Jonathan Sark set in the world of Magnamund, created by Joe Deaver. All rights retained by Holmgard Press. Ugh. Illustrations by Gary Ward, the walking flame symbol designed by David Marr, D10, and skull by Dean Spencer, used with permission. Music by Alexander Nakarada, used with permission. If you are playing on a phone, please hold the phone sideways. Yes, 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 I am, for the best experience. Okay, how to read this adventure. Unlike other stories, Shadows Over Fire is not read from page one to the finale. Instead, at the end of every section, you will be told to turn to another section, usually based on the choice you are given to make. This is because, unlike other stories, Shadows Over Fire is an entirely choice-based experience. Your decisions affect the narrative as well as whether you live or perish. Notes for accessibility. If you're in the little room, we're gonna go there. What you need to keep track of. All you need to read this adventure is a small piece of paper, which will be referred to your action card. I have here my notes. Double-sided notes. We are going to pretty quick. Pop that up. No longer notes. This is my action card. God dang it, that's off center. Oh, you done it again. I have my pencil. Okay. You refer to as your action card and a pencil. The story will instruct you when to add something to the action card. You also need a way to select numbers when asked. Da-da-da-da. To select a random number, you can roll a 10-sided die, which I have right here. Or you can click on the symbol of the page you will find on the side of this text on the pages where a roll may be required. Combat. During a combat section, you will be told your opponent's endurance value and be presented with a table of results. Pick a random number and consult this table to find out how much endurance you and your opponent each lose. And then below is an example. I do also have a combat record paper right here for me to reference. I do not need it at this exact moment because I am not in combat, so I will just tuck that under my action card for the time being. Continue to choose number and subtract endurance accordingly until one of you is dead. On pages where you can perish, a skull icon will appear in the right sidebar. You should click on it if you have died. The one on this page does something, okay? When you are prepared to begin, alright, the story so far. So for the first section, what I am going to do is I am also going to be keeping a chart of where I have been so far. This is my action card, so that is going to be something separate. I am going to have here a catalog of what I've been. So this is the story so far section, so I'm just going to write SSF because otherwise that won't fit. And I am just going to set that up here. I will leave my action card there. Story so far. Formed sometime after the creation of the all-powerful Moonstone, against which all modern time is measured, the Order of the Waking Flame was formed in the magiocracy of the Desai to protect the kingdom against threats from other dimensions and serve the greater good. The women who make up its ranks, for only women are eligible for membership, consider themselves to be outside of the authority of the elder magi who ruled the land, after a feud with them many centuries past. Despite this, they are still an order that fights for the general good and dedicate themselves to investigating rumors and hints of trouble that the elder magi are spread too thin to give their attention. While the women of the order may be scouted and trained from a very young age, it is when they turn 19 that their true service begins. At this time, they are given the first of two brands that make up the Waking Flame's symbol, the half-lidded eye or the enveloping flame. Even then, they are only considered kindling initiates,
until they are given the second brand, and that does not happen until Nessa, the current head of the order, determines they have demonstrated the appropriate balance of strength and wisdom. The year is now MS 5000, 5000 years after the creation of the Moonstone, and the order is not what it once was, neither as numerous nor as powerful. Yet still you are proud to be amongst its members, eager and willing to do whatever is necessary to defend your homeland from the forces that would do it harm. Thus, when Nessa summons you to her stone study in the Order's underground lair, you are quick to respond. The room is comfortably cool, save from the final days of an elongated summer, where the sun has blazed with an anger like a toddler refusing to sleep. Nessa wears a black tunic with a white trim. Her hair is cropped short with streaks of gray dusting its otherwise dark edges. She is past 60, but it exudes a vibrancy that belongs to a much younger woman. Sitting in a straight-backed wooden chair at a wide table, Nessa silently reads over a series of letters, reports from various members of the Order. You stand, arms crossed, behind your back, patiently waiting for her to finish. Always the reports are numerous, and the Order considers even the slightest gossip or hint of superstition to possibly contain truth. It is Nessa's job as Order of the Flame to determine which are worth investigating and who to send on these missions. A family of merchants disappeared on the road from Dalobo to Herdos 3 days ago, Nessa says. At last, looking up from the letters and turning her striking eyes, one mint green and the other one yellow like the sun, to you expectantly. You shrug. Merchants make enticing targets. The authorities have called them bandits. What do you think? I think there's more, or else you wouldn't have summoned me. Nessa smiles briefly. You're right. In this case, only the people disappeared. Their horses and cargo were left entirely untouched. No signs of a struggle, which is why I need you to investigate the area. Find out what really happened and report back to me. There is something about this matter that disturbs me, she continues. But more disturbing is that I cannot say why. There are whispers that drift to me on the night's breeze, threats half glimpsed in the flicker of a candle. They speak of evils that have long been asleep, but which now begin to stir like smoke before fire. They speak of the Huntress. Your heart beats a little faster at these words. The Huntress is Ness's bogeywoman, a mercenary she has told you is working to try to bring back an old enemy of the Order. Nearly 200 years ago, the two high priests of the Sinris, a sect of inventive druids who combine herbcraft and necromancy, went to war with the Order and nearly destroyed it. The Order won this war, but only at great cost, and the two priests escaped, leaving Magnamund for another plane, where it is said they wait for a chance at revenge. The Huntress, Nessa believes, has a connection with these two. You think she is involved with this? You ask, whispering as though the Huntress may be listening in. My latest reports say she is in the north at the moment, in Summerlin. Nessa responds, but there is a shadow over the flame, and the more I study it, the more it becomes the shape of the Huntress. You bow. Then I leave at once, you say, before the shadow can put out the light. Now it says to turn to the first section. So, there is a photo on this page. It is this brand that I have. It is the brand of the Waking Flame. So, page one. Let's go ahead and write page one over on my section. I will actually keep this on the front until told otherwise. Sunlight has not yet graced the world when you set out from the hill town of Dalobu, heading north up the long and lonely road, roughly carved out to make a byway cutting through the Kantara jungle towards Herdos. A year ago, war erupted between the magiocracy of the Sai and the desert empire of Vasagonia. Much of the fighting has been kept to the naval battles along the Tantarius to the south, where the Vasagonia hopes to take control of the Desaian ports. Still, the war has closed the borders and hampered trade and much of the traffic that would normally clog the wide road between Dalbo and Herdos has been dwindled to a trickle. This leaves you alone with your thoughts, which are filled with Nessa's last warning. There is a shadow over the fire. It makes you think of how much has changed in the years since you first joined the Order. You recall the pride you felt when your days as a kindling were over and you were given your second brand. You now look at your left forearm, where the two branded marks have come together to make a half-lidded eye enveloped in flame. Every member of the Waking Flame starts with one of the symbols and receives the other later according to how Nessa judges their character. The flame represents strength and power, while the eye represents wisdom and intuition. You were first marked with... honestly, I'm not very strong or powerful. I'm also not very wise, and my intuition kind of sucks. But I feel like I am dumber than I am not powerful. So I will pick the flame. The flame. Turn to 17. Alright, I see. Yes. Yes. The sight of the flame always awakens deep memories in you. You never knew your true mother and spent your early years working for your meals as part of a cargo ship. The shipmaster was not a cruel man, but he was a businessman and he never let you forget that you were property, even going so far as to name you Tetha, which means mule in Vakuros, the primary Desaian tongue. You were 12 and he sold you to Nessa to recoup the losses of a particularly poor trading trip. Nessa may have bought you, but she made it clear she never owned you. The first thing she did was offer you a choice. I will give you coin to go wherever you wish and be whatever you want, she said. Or you may embrace the strength I see inside of you and join me. You gently trace the line of the flames on your arm. Since those early years, you have gained the eye as well. Though always you have felt more connected to the strength of the flame, you kept the name given you by the shipmaster, wearing it like a badge of pride to show your resilience. How you will keep burning against even the greatest of storms. At the top of your action card, write your name, Tetha. Alright, action card. And name. Tetha. You are resilient and quick, like fire itself. Write down the word endurance, and next to it, the number 23. And we are going to write this as EP, endurance points, number 23. Okay. This represents your overall health, and you may be asked to reduce it during the adventure. You may never go above the initial score. If it ever reaches zero, your life has ended and the adventure is over. Also on the card mark the following: 2 short swords, a backpack, flint and tinder, water skin, blanket, and either a rope, torch, or meal. You choose one. So, we are going to write that. Let me double check.
There's my lines. Okay. Let's go ahead and write. This is my inventory. How many letters? Okay, invent dot. We're going to write two short swords. A backpack. We are going to write flint and tinder. Water skin. A blanket. Now I can choose a rope, a torch, or a meal. So I have flint and tinder to make fire. So do I need the torch? Rope is pretty useful. Or a meal, because in this game, well, at least in Lone Wolf, you need to eat every day or you lose endurance. Well, every time it tells you to eat, I guess. I'm gonna choose a rope. Because I don't have a rope. I'm sure I'll get food somehow. Finally, you have the ability Feet of Strength. Once this adventure, you can execute an incredible act requiring strength. You will be told when you can use this. Be careful, using it too soon may result in you wishing you had it later. Alright, so I have an ability now. I think the maximum things that I can have in my inventory is 10. So let's go down a couple spaces. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is 10. Let's do... let's do like 5 more just in case. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 4. And 3. Here. We will write our abilities. Okay, and the ability is called Feet of Strength. We'll hold on to that. Now we turn to 30. So, no, that's my combat record. On here, I went to page 17. I chose a rope. Now I'm on 30. Okie dokie. It takes you 3 hours of walking under the hot sun before you come to the area where the caravan was found, marked by a freshly staked signpost the Vekuros authorities put up. A warning burned into it, black and stark against the green wood. Bandits in area. There is little else to see. The authorities have already removed the wagon and the horses, taking ownership for a fortnight while they wait for someone to claim them. Selling them at auction if no one does. If it weren't for the newly posted sign, you wouldn't even be able to tell anything had happened here. To the east of the road, you spot a hunter's path, a clearing of brush made by cuts of a machete to allow hunters to easily traverse the area and set their traps.
The wilderness around Dalabol, the Kantara jungle, is home to a small number of people like this who live on what nature and their skills at trapping can provide. Perhaps one of them knows more about what happened here. Perhaps not. If you wish to search the road for clues, turn to 43. If you wish instead to walk the path and see if you can find a hunter, turn to 16. My instinct wants me to search for clues. But they did say that everything was pretty much cleared up and there's not much left to see. Because I'm not a very confrontational person. They want me to find a hunter. Okay. I guess let's see if we can find a hunter. Let's assume the best. Turn to page 16. And it was hunter. Okay. The byway has just stopped being visible when a deep voice calls out with an urgent command. Oi! Stop, Yetta! Don't take another step! A giant of a man emerges from the jungle. He has a full head of bright red hair and a beard to match. Slung over his right shoulder is a long bow so big you doubt you could pull the string, while at his waist hangs a naked machete, running with the sap of jungle weeds. He holds up his broad, calloused hand to show you he means no harm, then kneels in front of you and carefully brushes aside a scattering of fresh-cut leaves and branches, revealing the spring-loaded bear trap hidden there. He wipes sweat from his brow. You're lucky I was out checking the game trails, he says, the sunlight glinting off the fangs of the trap. Otherwise, you might have lost a foot. Not wise right now for a traveler to leave the road, not with the disappearances. You know about the merchants? You ask. Merchants? The hunter asks, his voice thick with the accent of a northern homesteader. I'm not doing that. I'm gonna sound like Inspector Mooney. We're not playing that game. I haven't heard anything about... It keeps writing merchants. It wants me to say, I haven't heard anything about merchants. I'm talking me animals, dogs, hunting dogs, well trained. Three gone missing in the dead of night. No trace of them. There's something out there. Something what comes down from those cursed mounds. The mounds. He is speaking of the Laud Mounds, a desolate land of hills and old ruins that lie past the jungle in the northwest. That's a distance from here, you comment. Aye. He agrees, pushing fingers through his red beard. We used to range there, for the game is not much hunted, but evil has claimed the land. Our last hunt, me wife and I heard things in the fog. Then the dogs start their yapping and yowling, and off they are. Never mind my curses. Of the five that went, only one came back. And him so broken he ain't good for nothing but sitting by the fire now. Bring dogs into this. He straightens and looks around uneasily as though the trees are listening. If you're seeking something in the Lob Mounds, you best avoid the jungle. Take the long way down the road towards Herdos and then follow the river. It's what sensible folk do, or would, if it were sensible to go to the mounds in the first place. Evil cannot abide the swift running waters. The disappearance of the dogs sounds disturbingly like the disappearance of the merchants. Close enough that you must investigate. The rest of his advice may be based on myth, but it is good guidance nonetheless. The river path is a longer way to the mounds, but a surer one. Right clue missing dog on your action card.
Okay. So, it appears it wants me to write it like here. I feel like my clue section will probably be longer than what the book wants for me, so... I want to give some space in between. I'm going to write it here. Okay, let's just give a little space here. And we will write... Maybe I'll just write clues. Okay. Yeah, missing dog. Dogs. Missing dogs. I just want to say before I continue, I'm so fucking sorry. In case I offended anyone, I'm so sorry. That's how it's written. But I still feel bad. Do you wish to reveal who you work for to the hunter in hopes he may tell you more? He seems nice enough. Not really one to lie. Are we secretive? I don't think we're secretive. Okay, I'm just gonna assume he's a good guy. Let's see. Yes. So let's turn to page 63. I hope I'm not about to enter my first combat. I now feel bad for this guy's dogs. So I said yes. Reveal. I don't know. And then that took me to page 63. Okay. You call to the hunter to wait, and he does. His quizzical expression changes to one of shock when you pull down the sleeve of your tunic and reveal the brand. With both hands, he makes a gesture, a triangle around his left eye. The sign is quickly dropped, turned awkwardly into a movement of brushing of the knees of his trousers. Some of the small folk of the size still know and respect the order. Fortunately for you, you've come across one of these people. As I said, a merchant caravan was attacked near here, you explain. Only the people disappeared. Only the people disappeared. I've come looking for why. I told ya, it's the evil that's taken over the Lord Mounds, the man says. More than that, I cannot say. The old spirits have long stopped watching over it. Their shrines overgrown and forgotten. All that's left are shadows. He reaches under his collar and pulls out a simple necklace, a symbol of Ishir, goddess of good, high priestess of the moon, which he presents into your hands. It is also carved the runic symbol for 33, a number that has superstitious importance to some homesteaders of this land. Then, without another word, he leaves. You watch him go, observing that here was a man taller and stronger than most, made so afraid by whatever it is you are seeking as to not be able to even speak of it. Add the chain of Ishir to your action card and make note of the number 33 next to it. No, why do you give me this? Now I feel like something awful is going to happen to him.
Okay, I am adding that into my inventory. So, chain. Hmm.
and add the number 33 next to it.
Sure.
Turn to 57.
You know what? I'll just set my combat card. My combat card.
No, stop. Oh, I'm stuck. My combat card. 57. Okay, and then nothing of note on there. It takes you the rest of the day to hike the long road and then follow the thin branch of river out to the west. During this journey, you will become hungry and you don't have time to forage enough to appease it. If you do not have a meal or do not wish to eat it, then lose 3 endurance. Erase the meal if you use it.
Oh, I took a rope.
I don't have a meal. So what we are going to do is we now need to lose 3 endurance. So we started with 23. We now no longer have 23. We now have 20. So I'll just put a dash and I'll write 20. As I continue to go along, yeah. You hike well into the night until exhaustion forces you to stop. You make a simple pillow out of your backpack and lay down in a clearing, staring up at the darkening sky, listening to the sounds of the river and the songs of insects. The first of the autumn breeze brushes past the palms and jungle growth to run cool fingers down your body. It feels incredible after your long hike. It does not take you long to fall into a peaceful sleep.
Suspicious.
Turn to page 22. Dawn comes slow, the sun stretching out its golden arms to drive away the night. Rain fell for half the night, leaving the jungle steamy and humid under now clear, hot skies. You wince as you uncurl from your position and begin your morning routine of stretches, doing them 3 times until your joints and muscles loosen and you feel a little more energized. For breakfast, you have a long drop of water and a handful of nuts and berries you gather in a short walk around the area. You continue to hunt for useful items to eat or craft throughout the morning and can add one of the following to your action card. A meal, which will stave off hunger, a healing poultice, which restores 4 endurance after combat, gone after 1 use, a torch, which you fashion out of a large branch and the oil of a certain leaf. I haven't had a meal, but I feel like if I needed to use one, now is the chance. And I would take the healing potion. It says it restores 4 endurance, and I've already lost 3, but you can only restore up to your max. You can't like do +1. So unless I lose 1 endurance in the battle that I would have, the entirety of that wouldn't get used. And I can only use it after battle, so even if I get hungry again, I can't use it to restore what was lost to hunger. Gosh, I hope I don't die. Wouldn't that suck? I guess I will take the healing. Poultice, and hope that is not a bad decision. Okie dokie.
By mid-morning, you have broken through the tree line and stare out across a drab landscape of muddy valleys and hills, stacked neatly on top of each other until they become sharp, peaked mountains, rising out of the steamy fog many miles to the north. Before you lie the low mounds, a fallow land where weeds and scrub grass provide most of the color, and only thick-thorned blackberries live. Only in the deep valleys do trees flourish, and then they are old omnious behemoths who greedily gobble up the sunlight before it ever reaches the valley floor. It is spoken by the people of Dalbo that the hills are cursed, though none can agree who or what cursed it. If your name is Kiladrasi, turn to 46. Otherwise, pick a direction. I can head north towards the distant mountains, or I can head west towards the deeper valleys. My name is not Kiladrasi, so I need to make a decision. I haven't watched Star Wars, but if I've learned anything, it's that you always want the high ground. Always go for the high ground. So, I'm going to go to the mountains. So for that, I need to go to page 11. Let's do that. At times, there's a path you follow, an old road rimmed intentionally by black river stones and mostly hidden under the tangles of blackberry thorns. At other times, you are left to find your own way up the hills, which grow ever more steep the closer you come to the peaks. The Zulun Mountains are still miles away, but jutting up in front of you, like their offspring, is a tall bluff of black jagged rocks, its sides steep and intimidating. On its squats is a broken wall and turrets of gray stone, all that remains of what once was a tall fortress with a view stretching all the way to the jungle. To reach it, you will need to climb. If you have a rope, turn to 21. Otherwise, you can attempt to climb without a rope, or you can continue down into the valleys of the Bald Mountains by turning to 34. I have a rope. I think I'm gonna use it because this seems important and that I'm gonna get hurt if otherwise. So we are going to go to page 21. Here on my inventory, I have my rope. What we are going to do is we are going to just cross that out. Yeah, that's crossed out. 21. The jagged rock juts out in many places, providing ample hold for you to secure your rope, making the climb much easier. Oh! Despite this, you are still pouring sweat and breathing hard by the time you reach the top. Lose one endurance, you regather your rope before continuing on. Do not erase it from your action card. Hold on, I need an eraser. One, I need an eraser. Two, hey. All right, we lost one endurance, so now we are at 19. I don't like this. I have an eraser. I'm just going to try to erase that line that I made to cross out my rope. And I guess I will not be crossing it out. I will be erasing it. I guess that makes more sense. I will rewrite the word rope. But hey, I gotta keep my rope. Now, on the corner of this page, I see a little skull. So I'm a little worried what's gonna happen. Turn to 56. Okay. 56. Oh wait, I forgot. I think that was page 11. I wrote, I use rope or something?
I don't know. One of these was I used my rope. Yeah. After much effort, you pull yourself over the lip of the cliff, and with a final heave, you find yourself crouched before the base of the castle. Remember, if you use your feat of strength to reach this section, you may not use it again this adventure. Old and broken, with only 3/4 of its wall and 1 towering turret intact, still the brave fortress is an intimidating sight. Its wall is not made of straight stone, but rather entire boulders fit and fused together, an act you can only think was possible through the hands of giants or the arcane tools of powerful mages. Whoever they were, and whatever their purpose, its original creators are gone, leaving behind only mystery and ruins. The wind sweeps over this rocky bluff, buffeting your face with your hair. You tie it back with a bit of twine and walk forward over the broken faces of grim beasts, carved into stone that has long ago fallen from its perch, passing underneath the arc of a doorless gate. You come into the castle courtyard. Shadows are everywhere, the gloom deepened by the umbra of the towering peaks in the distance. Then one of the shadows shifts, and you realize you are not alone. A man is in the courtyard, greasy black hair curtaining his features, hands rubbing hard furrows into his brow as he paces back and forth, the very image of anxiety. He wears boiled leathers and a battle axe is slung across his back. You see each other at the same instant, and he staggers as if struck. In one movement, shrugging the strap of his axe off his shoulder so that the hilt swings into his hand. "Who are you?" he calls out. "Answer me or answer to my blade." If you believe this man could aid you and wish to explain what that you are seeking for the lost merchants, turn to 26. If you wish to lie and say you are here seeking relics, turn to 39. If you wish to remain silent and pull back into the darkness, turn to 20. I don't think I should lie, and I don't think I need to not say anything and just hide in the darkness like I'm Harrow Harkonnen, I guess, and this is something. So I'm just going to explain what I'm here for. Telling the truth and being upfront about my intentions seems to be working out so far. So I'm going to go 26. I'm just gonna say explain. I might change how I write this section later, but that's what I need for now. Okay. "I am in search of a missing group of merchants," you say, stepping forward with your hands raised. Their wagons and all their goods were found abandoned on the road to Herdos just a few days past. "Why do you care?" the man demands. "You with the Vecros? "I represent another interest," you say. "One who wishes to keep a safe flame burning." If this were someone born in Dalwol, your reference would explain everything. As it is, the man only scrunches his face into a scowl. "Keep your riddles for another time. This is serious business. I knew those merchants, Mirka and his wife, Furla. Their eldest son and his wife also travel with them." You study the man's mud-stained armor and boots, the face whose creases are lined with road dust. "You were hired to guard them," you guess, lowering your hands. The man grimaces. "I stepped away for a moment, just to answer a call of nature. When I got back, they were all gone." If you wish to ask, what do you think happened here? Turn to 71. If you ask, what brought you here? Turn to 7. I guess I am going to say what brought you here, because the guy with the red hair is like, nobody with any common sense will go up to the Lod Mounds So I know why I'm here, and that's because I don't have any sense that I'm on a mission. Why is this guy here? Okay, let me do 7. There were signs of a mighty struggle. Looked like they'd been attacked by jungle predators. I set off at once. It was not hard to see they'd been dragged into the jungle, but after that, things got harder, the man explains. It was like tracking the wind. But several days later, it led me here. Same trail you probably followed, right? You look like you know your way around, trail sign. You give a non-committal shrug. The man reslings his axe. My name is Grimshaw. I think we can help each other. Come, I need to show you something. Okay. Turn to 32. Grimshaw leads you to the castle's one standing tower and mounts a set of spiraling stairs, warning you to mind the gaps. This place was old when the Elder Magi were young, Grimshaw grumbles as you leap over a place where 4 stairs in a row have fallen. Not likely, you think, as the Magi have not been young for 8,000 years, but you keep your observation to yourself. A short time later, you are at the top floor of the turret. A huge gouge has been taken out of the western wall, leaving an entrance to open air through which the wind whistles. This is where Grimshaw points. I've been keeping watch here for any signs of something suspicious. And well, down there, between the 2 largest boulders at the base of the next hill over. You move to the hole and look out upon a land turned into a muddy orange by a setting sun. The mists are setting in the valleys, but you can see the 2 rocks easily enough. They jut from the earth like the fangs of a buried beast, the sunset tipping them with a bloody red. You squint and peer closer. There is a person standing in the shadow of the rocks, staring up at the castle. You have the unsettling feeling that their eyes are piercing the distance between you. Do you wish to study this person further, or do you wish to step away from the hole? Am I gonna stare at this guy? Why don't we? A person. It doesn't sound like they're a creature. But then again, it is rude to stare. Well, if they already saw me, I might as well. Turn to 78. Oh shit! Okay. One moment. I'm just gonna write the word stare. With sudden, unexpected force, you are flung forward and off the tower, falling into open air. You do not fall long enough to have a chance to scream, but it is far enough to shatter your skull on impact with the rocky ground. Your life and your mission end here. I die from staring at a guy. I was like, staring is rude, I shouldn't do it. Oh no. Okay. Here's what we are going to do, right? So 78, this is the page where I died. And we are going to just write death. Just death. Because it's page 78 where I died. So I'm gonna write death. Big old line. Yeah. Okay. And now give me a moment and I will reset this. Hey everyone, Lety here, after I've already finished the adventure, and I realized that this video is 2 hours long, which is too long, so I am going to be cutting it into two parts, and I'm going to be ending this first part here. So get out there, do all the stuff, and I'll see you next time. Bye!